On This Week in Enterprise Tech, Cisco is at threat level 10. We've got a device that's going to tick off the NSA, and Karl Auerbach from InterWorking Labs is here to show you the KMAX. Quiet on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. Hi, everybody. It's time for our annual audience survey. We'd really like to hear from you. It helps us understand our audience better, know what you like and don't like, how you listen to the show. It also helps us tell advertisers what kind of people listen. But I promise you, your feedback is always kept personally anonymous. All you have to do is visit twit.tv/survey and let us know what you think. It'll just take a few minutes, and it'll help us make Twit even better. We really appreciate your support and any help you can give us. twit.tv/survey.
This is Twit, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 176, recorded February 12, 2016. Karl Auerbach and the KMAX. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by Citrix GoToWebinar. Connect and convert qualified leads with GoToWebinar, the leading platform for engaging online events. For a 30-day free trial, visit GoToWebinar.com today. And by Casper, an online retailer of premium mattresses for a fraction of the price, because everyone deserves a great night's sleep. Get $50 off any mattress purchase by visiting Casper.com/Twiet and enter the promo code Twiet. And by Drobo, a family of safe and expandable yet simple-to-use storage arrays. Drobos are designed to protect your important data forever. Visit Drobo.com/Twit and use the code TWIT100 to save $100 off the Drobo 5D, Drobo Gen 3, Drobo 1200i, or Drobo B810N. Welcome to Twiet, This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But I'm not guiding you by myself. I'm joined by my regular cast of characters, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, welcome back from the plague.
Yeah, thanks, Padre. It was not a fun cold at all. I've got kind of the Eeyore, oh dear, type of thing going right now.
But I will say, we did have a special visit from you in the last episode, and if you didn't watch it, you should go back and download and watch it, where you promised that you would give anyone in the audience their own IPv4 address. So thank you very much, D-Bert.
Yeah, thanks, Padre.
Oh, a man who is not hanging out IPv4 addresses is Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, good to have you, our correspondent from the right coast.
It is great to be here, Padre. It's a beautiful winter's day here in Florida in the low 70s. It's good to be here with everyone on Twiet.
That's the weird thing. It's cold over there. It was 75 degrees in my room this morning when I woke up. So something weird is happening to weather patterns. But let's not talk about that, because we're here to talk about networking, and we've got a great show. Not only will we be doing our standard blips and bytes, but we've got Karl Auerbach from InterWorking Labs. He's going to be demonstrating the KMAX. It's a way for you to simulate a real-world environment, a networking environment, in your own lab. But before we get to that, let's go ahead and jump into the blips. Now, we all know this. PC sales are down. Windows 10 was a freebie. Windows Phone is on the ropes. The global economy is tanking, and yet Microsoft beat the expectations of Wall Street with a $25.7 billion quarter four of 2015. By now, most know that PC sales took a beating last year, down 8.3% in Q4 alone, and Windows Phone is all but on life support. But a surging cloud business has quickly remade Microsoft into the services company that Satya Nadella has pushed since the start of his tenure. And the news gets better for Redmond. Office 365 went from 9.2 million subscribers at the end of 2014 to 20.6 million in 2015. Azure was up 5% to $6.3 billion. And even the Surface is up 29% year over year to $1.4 billion. All of this pushed profit from $5.8 billion in quarter four of 2014 to $6.4 billion year over year.
eBay's Kylan makes sense of big data. How did eBay know to order enough hoverboards to cover Christmas demands in December of 2015? They used Kylin. Kylin is open source code that began as a project inside eBay as it cast about for a tool that could make sense of all the data flowing into Hadoop. eBay needed to be able to look at data in 10 billion rows from multiple angles and do it quickly. Kylin leverages Hadoop's ability to scale out to thousands of nodes on a server cluster and make use of the distributed processing enabled by MapReduce. At the same time, it can field SQL queries from a data visualization system like Tableau and return ANSI standard results. Now, Kylin is not the only tool invented at eBay to work with Hadoop. They've also produced Eagle, a data monitoring tool, as well as Pulsar, a data visualization and reporting framework. Both of those are also open source code, but it's Kylin that has won the widest following, now used by many other companies, including Baidu, Expedia, JD.com, VIP.com, and China Mobile.
Well, a big warning. Beware. Tug on the faceplates of those credit card readers. In a scary new development, some amazingly cool credit card skimmers have appeared in the wild that fit perfectly over the Verifone credit card readers that Safeway is using. Unless you tug on the faceplate, you'll never spot them. With the advent of some really cool new thin circuitry, hackers have placed skimmers on a few Safeway credit card readers. So make sure you tug on the faceplates before you run your credit card.
Hey, it looks like VMware is going for bring your own device. VMware has been moving quickly to reorganize themselves after a disastrous 2015. They've already cut their workforce, deprecated their private cloud services, and made moves to embrace their competitors' clouds for hybrid service. As part of this newer, faster, leaner VMware, this past week they also rolled out a new platform for BYOD aggregation. Called Workspace ONE, the self-service single sign-on platform enables secure identity tokenization to give enterprise employees a way to securely subscribe to mobile, cloud, and Windows applications from all of their devices. With pricing of $8 per month per user of their cloud-based service or $150 per user for on-premise licensing, VMware is hoping that Workspace ONE's ability to put both identity authentication and device management in a single space will pull compliance-wary IT folks back onto the VMware team.
Microsoft has 74 device partners that will help it bring Office to Android. Microsoft announced earlier this week that it's broadening its mobile footprint in a major way. Redmond announced mobile-focused partnerships to bundle Microsoft's apps and services on Android smartphones and tablets with a total of 74 device makers in 25 countries. As part of the deal, the partners are offering Android devices with Word, Excel, Outlook, PowerPoint, OneNote, OneDrive, and Skype pre-installed. Microsoft has recognized its strength is not in mobile hardware, but in mobile apps, especially those built for productivity. The strategy is intended to boost the number of people using Microsoft products, which could in turn increase the number of people paying for Office 365 and premium features.
Train is getting derailed with a very hackable smart thermostat, further reinforcing our statement that too many IoT manufacturers aren't thinking about security. The Cisco Talos security team have discovered a large number of vulnerabilities in the Train smart thermostats that could potentially infect other devices on your home Wi-Fi network. Just goes to show that too many vendors either don't think about security or only add it on as an afterthought.
Hey folks, are you running a Cisco adaptive security appliance? If so, it's time to get patching. Yesterday it was announced that Cisco has released firmware for the ASA 5500, 5500X, ASA for Catalyst 6500 and 7600, ASA 1000V, ASA-V, Firepower 9300, and ISA 3000 appliances. Specifically, the firmware patches a buffer overflow vulnerability in the Internet Key Exchange protocol stack that allows an attacker to send malformed UDP packets to execute arbitrary code. As it allowed an attacker to gain full control of the system, the exploit scored a perfect 10, the highest rating in the CVE or Common Vulnerability Scoring System. The Internet Storm Center has reported that there is a significant increase of probes on UDP 500, the easiest port on which to run the attack. This seems to indicate that the exploit is alive and well in the net. And if you run any of those products, you need to patch now. Well, folks, that does it for the blips. Next up, we're going to be running into the bytes. But first, I want to thank a sponsor of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Now, let me ask you this. Have you tried to turn leads into sales? Have you tried to find those people who would make for good leads? Have you tried to find a system that would actually help you find those leads? Well, so you know the frustration that can come when you're trying to push out your service, your product, your company to the world. It's very difficult to choose one service, one product, one event that gives you everything you need, which is why we're happy to have Citrix GoToWebinar as a supporter of the Twiat Riot. GoToWebinar lets you present to hundreds of potential clients with confidence, letting you connect, captivate, and convert your target audience in one go. Now, here's how it works. You pick your topic, select your audience, and schedule your event. No, really, that's it. There's nothing else. That's all you have to do. GoToWebinar takes care of everything else with automated emails, custom branding, and practice sessions. Speaking of practice sessions, this is the part that I like the most. If you've ever tried using unified communications tools to present to multiple endpoints, then you know the buzzkill that is tech support during a presentation. There is nothing that derails your event, your talk, your presentation, than having to fix that 1, 2, 3 endpoints that just aren't working properly. Well, with GoToWebinar, your audience can test ahead of time so that they're ready when the time comes to be concerned about nothing else but you. Of course, it doesn't stop with prepping your audience for the presentation. During the event, GoToWebinar will keep your audience engaged with interactive polls, live chat, and real-time feedback. And once the event is over, you will immediately get one-click registration attendance and performance metrics. Basically, GoToWebinar enables marketers like you to easily reach your target audience, and you can turn leads into customers. Now, here's what we want you to do. If you are responsible for getting the word out about your company, about your company's products, about your company's services, then get started with GoToWebinar today and connect to convert. Go to GoToWebinar.com to start your free 30-day trial. That's GoToWebinar.com and your free 30-day trial. And we thank GoToWebinar for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. Let's go ahead and jump into the bites. This first one is, it's a follow-up of a story we covered 2 weeks ago when we talked about some new connection methodology, specifically Starry. T-Bert, do you remember Starry, the company that was started by the former CEO of, what was the name of the company that tried to make antennas that you could rent?
Oh, you would ask me.
Aereo. Right, Aereo.
Yeah.
That. So Starry used millimeter wave radio. Do you remember, what did we say about millimeter wave radio to the audience?
Oh, it can be blocked by lots of different things, but the key to this one is they're telling you got to put the antennas outside so it doesn't get blocked by tinted windows and things like that.
Exactly. Yeah, we were talking about the benefits of millimeter wave radio. In fact, we've both played with millimeter wave radio in different applications. You can get a lot of data over it. I mean, it is incredibly fast, but the problem has been that because you're running on such short wavelengths, so a millimeter, 10 millimeter wavelengths, it can be blocked by the molecules in the air that we breathe. It can be blocked by rain. And so the Starry system was to put a bunch of these Starry points onto rooftops where they could sort of mesh together and always have a line of sight to whatever customer they're trying to serve. Well, this week it's Google's turn to play with millimeter wave radio, and they've come up with a different approach. Now, Google is going to use much of the same millimeter radio tech, but they're going to raise the stations off of rooftops and put them onto solar-powered drones that are thousands of feet above sea level. Curtis, why would you do this? Why would you take these radios and put them so far up?
Well, the biggest thing is to know that it gets all back to line of sight. When you're dealing with frequencies in this range, it is line of sight. And when you put something up very high, assuming you don't place your ground station under a tree, then you've got pretty good line of sight. It's the same thing that allows people with very low-powered radios to talk to the International Space Station or even bounce signals off the moon. Line of sight wins when you go above a certain frequency.
Right, right. The way that they're doing this is, as I said, with those solar-powered drones, but it's unique. It's a project that they've codenamed Skybender. They've taken over 15,000 square feet of hangar space at Spaceport America to test the system. So they've got all the drones and all the support gear, and they're experimenting with what are huge autonomous solar-powered planes. I mean, imagine something with a gigantic wingspan. These are designed to fly way above the flight paths of commercial airliners. They're not saying exactly how high, but you got to figure it's between 50 and 80,000 feet, which means you need huge surfaces both to give you enough lift and also to give you enough solar panels. But Chee, let me ask. When we talked about millimeter wave radio before, we talked about its proclivity to get blocked. Going up that high isn't that even going to be more problematic? I mean, what is Google using to try to cut through clouds? I mean, we know moisture can stop a millimeter wave radio.
Well, when you start talking about things like that, you start talking about a phased array antenna system. So if you have, say, a rainstorm going on, if there's going to be space in between the drops, otherwise you call it an ocean, right? So right. By having multiple antennas offset just a little bit from each other, they're probably going to cover almost the entire bottom of this drone with a tiny little rate. The antennas actually kind of look like big jacks, you know, like little jacks that kids play with.
Right.
And by doing that, it's like having diversity antennas. If one gets a bad signal, the other one takes over. Big deal. So that's how you get around that type of thing. And millimeter works great when you get it way up high, and when you're generating the signals, there's not a whole lot of air up there. You know, they're probably talking about 50, 60,000 feet.
Right.
And when the air is nice and thin, the waveforms have a better chance of actually forming completely before they're sent down to the receivers.
Chiba, we've got Titus in the chat room who is saying, you know, wouldn't low Earth orbit satellites be a better candidate for this kind of transmission? I mean, could you put millimeter wave radio on a satellite?
I don't see why not, but the problem is low Earth orbit is still wicked expensive, just as Iridium.
Right.
And you have to actually put a constellation of them up there. Whereas with a drone flying around, it'll actually just do a racetrack around, say, a city or an area. And it means you only really need one, maybe two for a large metro area.
I think it's still something like, is it a $10,000 for every kilogram that you put into orbit?
I think it's more.
More than, yeah, no, it's significantly, yeah, exactly. So if Google can figure out a way to have vehicles that can basically give them 30 to 60 day orbits, bring them back down for servicing, and then send them right back up, unless those planes are costing $100 million each, it's still going to be more cost effective than putting up a low Earth orbit satellite.
This is not a new concept. There's been quite a few cellular carriers that we're talking about putting them up in blimps, you know, the size quite a bit larger than the Goodyear blimp. And the crews would just be up there for weeks at a time, and they just trade back and forth.
Yeah, yeah. And the other nice thing about this, I actually looked in a little bit into, they're being very mum about their technology, but I looked at one of their partners who does do millimeter wave radio. And in using the phased array, the one I think they're probably going to put on these planes, you can maintain something like 30,000 connections off of a single phased array. It's smart enough to be able to do creative interference between the antenna points. And it also means that you can get an individual connection to each. The wavelength of millimeter wave radio is so small that it's almost as if a device that is 5 feet away from another device, they're not interfering with each other at all. It's not like Wi-Fi in any respect, which I like. Curtis, let me ask you something. Google is doing this as one of their blue sky projects. This is a moonshot, but it's a moonshot with precedent. They did Project Loon not too long ago, and that actually is still working. Remember, in 2014, they launched 30 balloons into the stratosphere above New Zealand. All 30 are still working. All 30 are still in their orbits, just using ballast to go back and forth in the wind stream. So, yes, this is strange, and yes, no one else is doing this, but it is technology that's doable. They're pitching it as a way to deploy infrastructure, but do you see a use case for enterprises, once this technology matures, to have either an emergency deployment access point or to deployment for, say, you know, gas fields far, far away?
I think that the gas field scenario is much more likely than emergency because, let's face it, given the altitudes at which these things have to operate, deploying them during an emergency would require getting FAA sign-off. And an emergency is not when you want to go after special rules from a government agency. But when it comes to things like mining, oil and gas exploration, all sorts of other natural resources extraction scenarios where you do need connectivity to places that don't have a built-in communications infrastructure or an easy way to get one. This could be a very inexpensive way to provide that. It could also do things like dramatically lower the cost of internet connectivity for ships at sea. Chiebert can talk about what it costs to do internet from aboard a ship, and I suspect you can as well. And it would be nice if you could have free broadband from aboard a ship because it's so inexpensive to the ship owner. And that's the sort of thing where I see this having tremendous potential application.
Actually, yeah, shipborne internet connectivity would be so much faster. Chiebert, you had an Iridium endpoint with you on your last trip, did you not?
Yes, I did, except this one could only send 160-character SMS messages. But the cool thing is $60 a month gave me unlimited inbound and outbound 160-character messages.
Okay, so are you with Curtis on that? Do you see this as a boon to shipyards, to shipping companies? Because now it means they don't have to pay outrageous satellite fees to stay in touch with their fleets.
Perhaps, but I see it more as getting past the insanely expensive backhaul and rooftop rental agreements that carriers need. I would see it as a terrific way of handling, say, city and county services. Because one of the big problems is, you know, sometimes fire trucks are in places they need connectivity back to the fire chief, and it's just too expensive for them to have a typical system lit up all the time, and they need more bandwidth because they would desperately love to be able to drive, you know, HD or 4K drones with full thermal sensors flying around a large, say, 5, 10 alarm fire, and be able to give the fire chiefs the God's eye view of the disaster.
Well, I don't know about you two, but I am really looking forward to having some broadband in a box with a drone. So, Google, go at it. Let's do one more before we move on, because I don't want to run out of time before we get to Carl. This isn't a bite. This is more gadget lust. I'm going to be at Mobile World Congress 2016 in Barcelona in a week, and I'm starting to receive the flood of emails. It's just like CES or NAB. Every vendor is now sending over their proposal for us to come by their booth and give them some time. There was one company, a Finnish company by the name of XXLSec, which already, that's interesting name. They have a product they want to show off called the Priv Call or the Priv Call. This is what it looks like. Very nondescript. It could just be an aluminum hard drive enclosure for all I know. But what they promise this will do is to scramble your audio calls. So if you are in an area where you're not sure if your calls are being listened to, you don't have to worry about an encryption protocol baked into the phone. You don't have to worry about whether or not there's something in the phone itself that gives a backdoor to that encryption. This establishes a new layer of encryption so you can establish a point-to-point call that has end-to-end encryption. Now, here's how it's supposed to work. You have two endpoints, so you have two of these private calls that are connected to smartphones via Wi-Fi. The new contacts show up in the phone. So you have special contacts that are only stored inside the device. They only show up when the device is synced. The user selects another priv call or priv call endpoint from the contacts and then executes the call, and it establishes an AES 256 tunnel through which voice is routed. Now, that does go from one priv call to the other priv call, which both have 3.5-millimeter earphone jacks. So this is truly end-to-end encryption. Chiebert, I haven't seen a demo of this. In fact, the details were a little sketchy. Does this pass your smell test?
I'm surprised it actually hasn't happened sooner. Let's say this is not new in certain government sectors.
We can't all afford a SAT scrambler, Chiebert.
Yeah. The unfortunate fact of life is the original one that I got to play with was PGP phone. And shall we say it ran into a lot of problems, and it was hard to set up, and you needed pretty much a full-size computer to run it. These guys are probably putting in I would imagine probably something like a Cavium chip, something that's got the encryption processor built in. And my only thing is, gee, why hasn't it shown up sooner? And gee, wouldn't it be nice if this was a kind of a shoe thing that you could stick onto an existing phone? But this format that they're doing and going through the Wi-Fi, or I got to imagine probably Bluetooth would work too, is probably less risky for them because then it works with more phones.
Right, right. It's funny because the technical details that they spec'd out don't make sense to me because they also, they list Wi-Fi connectivity. They also list 3G and 4G. So I'm thinking, wait, if it has its own cellular connectivity, why do I need the smartphone? But I'll see when I get to MWC. To your point that this has been tried before, we actually showed off a few things on the new screensavers. Leo had these Wi-Fi Tor routers that I stole from the product room in the back. Very interesting devices that allow you to have an easy way to add a layer of encryption and obfuscation to your IP traffic. They work, but as you said, trying to get that to work with VoIP consistently has always been a pain. I'm very interested to see if they can pull this off. Now, they also state that at some point this could develop into sort of a mesh system where you could have endpoint to endpoint and then it jumps off onto the regular POTS system or GSM's CDMA system. But then, of course, you've got an endpoint that could get compromised, and now that's an issue. Now, let me run down really quickly all the details that they gave me. They claim 100% end-to-end encryption between two private call units. Communication is encrypted outside of the phone and network domain, so it doesn't matter what's on the phone. The only thing the phone will receive is the encrypted communication. It doesn't rely on the phone OS at all. It's compatible with Apple iOS, Android, and Windows phones. Does not share encryption process memory space with a mobile terminal. It's paired per host phone within Wi-Fi range by the press of a button. It's compatible with your organization's certificate. So if you want to stamp this with your authentic certificate, you can do that. Supports conference calls, encryption conference calls between several private call units. It's got a tamper-evident seal. So if someone's messing with it, you can figure out. Integrated battery, charging via micro USB charger, supports a 3.5mm interface jack for headphone hands-free sets, made out of aluminum, weighs 150 grams. Curtis, no pricing is mentioned. I'm hoping to get two of these units, or actually, let's see if we can get three of these units. We could do TWiET encrypted. Is this something that is sellable? Chiebert mentioned that geeks would love to have this, but do you see this as becoming popular for enterprises? I mean, if I still ran my IT department, I would tell people who are going to less than friendly countries that all communication, all verbal communication needs to happen through one of these. Do you see this being a demand?
Oh, I absolutely do. And I think it's going to be, as you point out, multinationals when they're sending people into different nations. I also think it will be popular for domestic use. I can see this being something that an awful lot of CEOs use when they're talking to members of the board, when certain people in research are talking, or when financial executives are having privileged conversations. And speaking of privileged conversations, this is a natural for attorneys to use when they're talking with clients. One of the reasons that we've seen so many attorneys get involved with security testing is that if the pen testers work for the outside counsel, then all of their results are privileged communications when they come back to the company. But how much better would it be if those were protected not just by legal privilege, but by actual encryption? So this is something I can see being very popular among the enterprise types, especially if it has a price tag that's closer to $500 than to $1,000.
Chiebert's in our private chat saying, hey, you know what? This would piss off the FBI and their stingrays. And yes, and that kind of tickles me, makes me feel a little happy. I will say this, something else that did not come out in the briefing, but it did come out with my email exchange with the representative is all of their software is open source. So everything that they've built, they've opened it up. So you can take a look at the code to make sure there's no backdoors, to make sure there's no funny business going on. You get to load on your own firmware so you can ensure that you're getting exactly what you think they're getting. In fact, I asked him, I said, well, why wouldn't you actually build this into a phone? And he said, because we want people to be able to say, this is the unit, this is an uncompromised unit, and no matter what I connect it to, it's going to be able to run the software I have validated and I can trust. So I don't know, spring 2016. Hopefully we get some of the first units. We'll test them out here on This Week in Enterprise Tech. Chiebert, I'll give you the last word on this. As a former, I'm not going to call you a spook, but as former spook support, what do you think about this compared to some of the encryption gear you have worked with?
It's as good or potentially better than some of the stuff that's that I have used in the past. It looks smaller. It's certainly less weight, you know, it has less weight and more portable. I think a lot of it's going to depend upon how much it costs, but I'll trust you. Trust me, it's going to be less than what I used to have to pay for government agencies.
Yes, but, you know, they can afford a $100,000 telephone, so we can't. Go figure. Well, folks, when we come back, we are bringing in Karl Auerbach. We've had him before. He is one of our most honored guests. If you don't know who he is, there's something wrong with you, and you need to Google him right now. But he's going to be talking about the KMAX. It's a way for you to simulate a real-world network environment inside of your lab. If you've ever wanted to do real-world testing but not risk all the, you know, death and pwnage, you're definitely going to want to stick around. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank Casper. Now, Casper is a different kind of company. Did you know that you spend up to 90% of your life in bed, according to a study I just made up? Now, it's not that much, but really, when you think about it, we spend about a third of our day sleeping. Don't you want that sleep to be as good as possible, as rejuvenative as possible, as restful as possible? Well, that's what Casper understands, and that's what they're trying to deliver to you. Casper's philosophy is based around obsessive engineering at a fair price. They combine two technologies, latex and memory foam, for a better night and a brighter day. It's a comfortable mattress that has just the right sink and bounce. A Casper mattress provides long-lasting comfort and support. It will keep you cool throughout the night with its breathable open-cell design, which means you're not going to wake up sweating like you do on a pure memory foam mattress. But it also means you're not going to sink into it, so you've got a backache when you get up. Now, here's my favorite part. Buying online is completely risk-free. Casper understands that the showroom experience is actually not an experience at all. What do you get when you go into a showroom? You get maybe 5-10 minutes for you to lie on a bed before you have to make a choice. Not so with Casper. With Casper, they will deliver it to your home, and then you get 100 days to decide if this is the mattress that you want to sleep on day after day, night after night. Now, as you know, statistically, lying on a bed in a showroom has no correlation to whether or not it's the right bed for you. You actually do need to try it. You need to get your dog on the mattress. You need to read on the mattress. You need to do what Leo Laporte is doing on his Casper. And that's exactly what they'll let you do. Customers who purchased a Casper mattress rated it 4.6 out of 5 stars. You should try sleeping on a Casper mattress today. And you can check out their new pillows. Their responsive dual-layer pillows adapt to your movements throughout the night. And of course, as always, Casper's mattresses are made in the good old U.S. of A. Folks, get a Casper mattress today. $500 for a twin or $950 for a king size. Compared to industry averages, that's an outstanding price. And you can save an additional $50 as one of our audience members by going to casper.com/Twyatt. That's casper.com/Twyatt and entering the promo code Twyatt. Again, that's casper.com/Twyatt with the promo code Twyatt. Terms and conditions apply. For details, visit casper.com/terms. A better night's sleep awaits with Casper. We thank Casper for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Folks, we welcome back to the show. This is my favorite part of every episode. Mr. Karl Auerbach of InterWorking Labs. Karl, first Hello. Of all, I love this new setup. What is this stuff that we see behind you? This looks like a geek maker paradise.
No, we're just one of the few offices around where with a weapon of mass destruction in the background. That's a prop from a play I worked on. You know, and we have the stuff to properly power equipments and jumper cables over there and to, you know, make sure equipment responds properly. You know, we break things, or I break things. And that's actually the theme of today's program is people don't break things often enough. People test stuff in the lab. They put it out on the net maybe for a while under friendly conditions, and then they start selling it. And eventually somebody discovers, oops, you know, it would be really bad, for example, if Boeing simply put out a brand new airliner, took it up on a sunny afternoon and flew it and said, great, let's put it into service. But unfortunately, on the internet with a lot of products, that's what people do.
Carl, let's talk about that, because that's actually something that Chibert has brought up before. Gear manufacturers love to talk about their specs. They love to talk about the throughput and every special piece of circuitry that they've added to the product that makes it better than every other manufacturer. But it's very difficult to find a manufacturer who will give you honest data on, A, have you tested this properly? Have you thrown every exploit against it to make sure that it's not going to get through? And B, will this actually work in the real world? I mean, we all know the phenomenon of real world performance not meeting what the technical specs say it will. Why is it? Is it just so difficult to test for exploits and real world experience?
Well, I don't deal in the word of exploits. We deal more in the area of just people make mistakes writing code, leaving the word unsigned off of the front of integer. That's a real common one in protocol implementations. We've seen that in voting machines where they get to 32,767 votes and then start counting backwards. No surprise to me, but it was to the people who made it. There's an old medical machine, a Therac something 25, that was basically a X-ray kind of machine. And it had a numeric keypad, and the operators would just go, you know, when they were testing, it would go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, put in the numbers. And after put in the field, and it worked fine. Then they went out in the field, and the operators got really good, and they do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And nobody ever tested N key rollover. So eventually, somebody got X-rayed to death. They got basically microwaved by this machine because of a software flaw. That's really hard to test for, because people aren't expecting it. Also, if we go to the internet, a lot of the protocols are not well-defined or incomplete. Like, for example, the IETF mailing list has been filled this week about problems with IP fragmentation. That's IP fragmentation is an old, ancient topic. Yet, there are so many variations of the way packets can be fragmented and reassembled that virtually nobody's code has gone through every possible condition. And I have not yet found a piece of code that will survive all the IP fragmentation patterns I can throw at it. So we have a lot of gear that's out there in the field that's work confined today, but may fail sometime in the future when presented with a new peer. And who are they going to blame, the new peer or the old equipment? Probably the new piece of equipment.
Carl, Curtis Chibert and I, we know your bona fides. We've seen your work at Interop. You are one of our golden children. You are one of the people who, when we talk about Interop being involved with X percent of the white papers that form the foundation of the internet as we know it, your name's right up there. You are one of our gurus that we go to time and time again to help us figure things out. And your expertise, as you have been explaining, has been to figure out, well, what happens when you take this piece of gear and you put it out into a real network, into a live environment. You described a few of the projects that you worked on. You helped to expose a problem with voting machines. You look for problems with X-ray machines. What are some of the other things, before we get into the KMAX, what are some of the other things that you've been working on that you think people maybe don't know about?
Well, there's a vehicle-to-vehicle communications. Automated cars are a big thing. Those cars are going to be talking to each other. Initially, they'll probably be more listening to each other, but ultimately, they will be exchanging information. Just think of the Mars climatic lander, where it crashed into Mars because one group was using metric and one group was using English units. We're going to have problems with vehicles that are beaconing information to one another, where there's generation one of the firmware versus generation two of the firmware, that it may have interesting interactions. There'll be emergent effects. We see people walking down a sidewalk coming towards each other, and they come across, and they go like this, and they go back and forth, and eventually they bang into each other. We're going to start seeing that kind of behavior with automobiles. And the makers are doing too little testing of multi-vehicle communications or communications under impaired conditions or communications where an unintentional error has been made, such as when a traffic crew moves a information beacon, like a traffic signal, or when somebody intentionally introduces bogus information. And there will also be what I call the Bubba mechanic effect, where your neighborhood mechanic pulls off, you've crashed your Chevy and you've got a damaged front distance sensor, and he says, oh, I've got this great Ford rear sensor I can duct tape in. We're going to have all kinds of interesting interactions of equipment all communicating with one another. And what I do is to try to create tools so that we can do some of these things in the lab, before they're out there in the field and actual automobiles bang into each other. We've also done this sort of thing with robotics. As the world becomes more mechanized, this kind of thing is going to become more and more necessary. And I also have a lawyer's hat, which says we makers of software have been evading liability for decades by licensing stuff. Eventually, the guillotine is going to drop, and they are going to have to face liability for the products they put out there. Yeah. And we have that problem right now with the Google cars, where the just declared that the car itself is the driver. Now, who's going to get the ticket when it's speeding or it stops or does something wrong?
I'm setting mine to Google. But, Carl, that's a great segue into actually talking about what we've brought you on to talk about. I mean, the last time you were here, you were talking about the DARPA robots, the robot challenge, which is fantastic. Everyone has watched hours of video of that challenge. This time, though, we're calling upon your experience of bringing equipment in the real world to show off something that you have created. Tell me about the KMAX.
Okay. The KMAX is not really a new idea. We used to have these things called TCP/IP bake-offs, where we would get a bunch of people together, bring our code, and just see what we could break with each other's code. They usually went on for 3 or 4 days. It was a lot of fun. Pillsbury got upset when we used the word bake-off, so we had to find another name for it. And John Postel was participating in these things, and he said, you know, we need a box that does things wrong, intentionally wrong. So he called it a flakeway, and it's written up in one of the RFCs from way back when about TCP and testing. Well, several years ago, I did a company to do a high-quality video back on the network back in 95. And if you use some of the video distribution protocols, RTP, RTCP, for example, they are really hard to test because there's a lot of very subtle timing things that can happen. And also, if you're trying to do synchronization of voice and on video, timing is all critical. And what happens if one packet arrives first? What happens if something gets out of order? We had no gear to test that. So I decided to go out and build one of these things. So over the last 10, 15 years, we've been building a series of products called Maxwell's after James Clerk Maxwell's thought experiment of a demon that could cause a hot area to get hotter and a cold area to get colder, a thing called Maxwell's demon. Well, we took that idea and put it into a little box called Maxwell. We had products out there for a couple of years doing these sort of things. And our newest generation is a whole brand new implementation, which we call KMAX for kernelized Maxwell. Some people think the K stands for Carl, but it's really kernelized. The first version of that is this little guy here. So I actually got something else on the screen there. Anyway, this is the first little guy. It's the entry-level version of the product there to test the ideas out, to work out the bugs and flaws, and then eventually we'll expand it into larger platforms. What it does is essentially I was going to show it to you here, the back panel, is it's a bridge between two of the ports.
A little higher, higher.
Okay.
There we go.
Yay! there's a port for control, and there's two ports which we're bridging data between. We can do more ports, but this one only has three. The idea is that we get between those two ports at layer two, and we do bad stuff to the traffic. Intentionally bad stuff, controlled bad stuff, sometimes even statefully bad stuff. And that bad stuff can include everything from simple things, what we call standard impairments, dropping things, delaying things, resequencing things, rate limiting, corrupting stuff, all those sort of normal things. We're also, in the future, going to be doing packet rewriting, smart rewriting of header fields in packets. We've got our larger products, which we will be importing into this later on, our protocol testing, where we'll do things like turning a TCP three-way handshake into a four-way handshake. That surprises a lot of implementations, perfectly legit. We will coerce things like the initial sequence number to be something that's right around where the high order bit flips, which is where a lot of implementation errors are found in code, or we've taken all the things which our implementation experience since the late 60s has shown that people make mistakes, and we put in tests for those. Right now, this box is the beginning of a whole new line of that. It has what is basically what we call the standard impairments. And I've got a screen up here I can show you.
Yeah, let's go ahead and demo this. Let's just show them what it looks like.
Yeah, let me figure out how to share a screen here. Not that great with Skype. There we go. Share screen. And I'll take that screen. Okay. Can you see it yet?
It should pop up in just a second. And
come on, Skype.
Come on, Skype. Do your thing. There we go.
Oh, yay.
So this is the actual interface.
This is one. Yeah, one of the interfaces. This is one scenario. We have many, many scenarios. This is a five-band scenario. We have ones that are single band. We have ones that are based on templates where you can say, I'd like something that looks like a low-Earth orbit satellite or a high-Earth orbit geosync satellite or a low-Earth orbit geosync satellite, if you can figure out such a thing. Or a radio handoff where you're fading out from one base and moving into another. We have scenarios for all that. But this is a basic one. The idea is, you got an interface on one side. You got another interface. Can you see my mouse?
Yeah.
An interface on the other side. And what we go is a packet comes in one interface. It goes through a classifier. I'm going to move to the other side here. It's closer to me. And we can classify that into according to some filter expression. Here's one that's basically picking UDP packets that are shorter than 255 bytes and classifying it into one of these bands. What I've got set up here now is a packet that arrives on this interface, goes in. If it's meets the filter expression, which is a small UDP packet, it goes into the, what we're calling band one here. If it doesn't meet any expression, it goes into the default band, which is this top level thing here. And we've got these little meters here. They're telling us that roughly how many packets are going through this right now. There's a VoIP call flowing over this right now. And that's some graphs. You can see the packets going over that. Now, what we can do is we've got various things we can do to this. We can delay it. And we can put in all kinds of interesting delay patterns. We can put in a constant delay. We can put in a delay that's varying according to, a Gaussian distribution. We can put in, we can vary the parameters of the Gaussian distribution, or we can vary the delay based on a time pattern. I'll show you that in a minute. We can do all kinds of things there. And let me just get out of that.
So basically, everything from drop packets to delay to jitter, you can simulate that.
Yeah, in delay, jitter is a form of delay. It's a varying delay. And in this case, I can set up a thing where I'm basically delaying over a Gaussian distribution. I can set the mean and the standard deviation of that distribution. I can also pick how many packets do I want to have subjected to that delay, all of them, none of them, some collection of that. I can also add a fixed delay to that, so I can bias the Gaussian distribution off. So I can have like 100, 150 millisecond baseline, and then I can put the bell curve off to the right of that. And then, of course, I can vary that over time. For example, one of the things that's really kind of fun to do with TCP is I can create a sawtooth wave where I have a raw delay of, say, 0 milliseconds, and then over a period, say, of 60 seconds or something, I will bring that up to, say, 500 milliseconds, just a linear, and then just drop it back down to zero, and then begin it all over again. That seriously exercises the congestion detection and recovery algorithms in TCP, many of which do not do very well in those scenarios. We've seen one company that was selling basically web servers that they backed off beautifully, but their recovery algorithms didn't recover.
Right.
So there's all kinds of fun things you can do with that. Now, what I've got running here is I've got a simple drop pattern running on this VoIP call. And I've set up a little time-based variation here so that over a curve, I have a baseline of a few seconds. I think it's 3 seconds. Then I go from a drop level of 0% up to a pretty serious 80% packet drop. I hold that for a few seconds. I think 4 seconds, that's my hang time here, then drop it back down to zero. And my call is going through that. And you can hear the effects of that. I can place a call and you tune you in and you can hear me talking through that. What'll happen is while we are on this part of the curve, where if you can see my mouse, the call will be pretty good. And it's going to get seriously, seriously, seriously bad. Then it'll recover again. It'll just keep going through that.
Right, let's
do it.
Let me
do that.
Yeah.
Let me do that now. I have to fuddle with the soundboard here. I'm going to turn off my main mic, and I'm going to turn on the mic for the phone. So here we go.
And I should be hearing through the VoIP call. You should be getting bad. I'm probably
Everyone knows that sound.
Okay. Yeah. And now it should be good again. And it's going to get bad again. And we're just recycling.
Oh, that's phenomenal. I love this.
A real microphone.
That is a great testing tool. I mean, and actually, the interesting thing is your VoIP call was okay until you got above about 50% packet loss. At 50% package loss, we could no longer make you out.
I wanted something that was really overt for this call.
Yeah.
Normally, packet loss comes in bursts, and we have tools for we can go into the details of all of this for describing burst patterns. We can enable bursts. We can set up basically a Markov chain of for packet n plus one, what's going to be the fate of packet n plus one based on what happened to packet n? And there's a probability chain there. And then we can also scale that probability based on the time since the prior packet. So we've got lots of flexibility there. And, of course, we've got this whole variation waveform thing here. So we can vary the parameters of those functions over time. So we can set up virtually infinitely complicated patterns. Many of which probably have no practical use, but many of them do. The thing here is we're trying to push protocol implementations into areas that have probably not been experienced under lab conditions. Most test networks and labs do not cause packets to go out of sequence, but that's real-life networking. As you get out onto the real internet, packets will start getting out of sequence because they'll take different paths. Should I go back to the main screen here and drop this?
Go ahead and go back to your camera so we can see you again.
Yeah, we can also graph stuff here too.
Yeah.
There I am again. Anyway.
Hey, Carl, I want to go ahead and bring in my co-host here in just a bit. We're going to let's dive a little bit deeper and talk about what this actually means, because we've got Scott Aron in the chat room who's saying this reminds him a lot of smart bits, which is a great comparison. But let's talk a bit more about where...
Over my shoulder.
Oh, yeah. Actually, go back to his camera. That's what the mallet's for?
No, down below. If you zoom out, that's a Spirent smart bits down there. And underneath, it's an Ixia device.
Just have $250,000 worth of gear on a rack. It's cool. It's cool. Yeah. But, Carl, we're going to be right back with you. But before we get to you and my co-host talking about the overall meaning of having a tool like this, let's go ahead and thank the next sponsor of This Week in Enterprise Tech, and it's Drobo. Now, folks, if you've been around Twit for a while, you know that Drobo was one of the original sponsors. They were with Leo in the cottage. They brought him the device that he uses to this day to shuttle information back and forth between his home and the studio. Now, for your storage needs, Drobo, I'm going to say it's a different kind of company that understands it's not just about size. It's not just about speed. It's not just about reliability. It's about a combination of all those things, about you choosing the exact tool that you need for the job. Now, where does Drobo fit into the enterprise? Well, they've got tier two storage, backup, bulk storage, entry-level virtualization, work groups that produce images, video, and media, and, of course, all of it online. Now, the Drobo 1200i is a 12-drive rack-mountable iSCSI storage array. It has 3 gigabit Ethernet ports, and it's under a $5,000 array, which they say is ideal for backup storage or as a cost-efficient way to build nearline archives to keep important but infrequently accessed data online. Now, if you provision it with 2 or 3 SSDs, IOPS for transactional operations are accelerated. This is one of the things I like about their Beyond RAID system. You can use an SSD to take rotating storage and make it fast. If it guesses right, you get blazing fast speed, faster than you can even push across Ethernet. Now, the Drobo B810N is an 8-drive rack-mountable file-serving appliance. It has 2 gigabit Ethernet ports that support port bonding for those folks who really need a lot of extra speed. Now, this array is an ideal backup target for work groups under 100 people. Oh, here in the brick house, we use Drobos that are directly connected via USB or Thunderbolt. The idea is sometimes you just need a big stack of storage. You don't need something online. You just need something that you can move between the home and the office, plug into the computer that needs to use it at that particular time, address it, and then disconnect it. And that's what I love about Drobo, the fact that they're willing to give you those flexible options because they know that you need to choose the tool that's right for you. Drobos are reliable. Data is received by your Drobo and not yet written to disk is protected. If there's a sudden power loss, which anyone who runs a NAS knows that's the worst case scenario. To have data being in transit during a power loss can kill an array. Not so with Drobo. Drobos have an internal eUSB device where data is copied if there's a power failure. It protects against long outages. It's also expandable. You can expand or replace a Drobo with ease. Now, no tools are required to change the drives out. Their Beyond Raid technology lets you expand on the fly and mix and match drives. Also, it supports Thunderbolt, Gigabit, and USB 3.0 connections. Basically, if you want it, they've got it. So here's what we want you to do. We want you to try Drobo. Visit drobo.com/twit to learn more and check out their complete line of products. When you use the code TWIT100, you'll save $100 off a Drobo 5D, Drobo Gen 3, Drobo 1200i, or Drobo V810N. That's drobo.com/twit, drobo.com/twit, and use the code TWIT100. And we thank Drobo for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. Let's get back to it. We've got about 10 minutes here, and we've been having a great conversation with Karl Auerbach of InterWorking Labs, talking about his new KMAX, which is a way for you to simulate real-world network conditions inside your lab. Chievert, you've played with smart bits. You've got an Ixia box. At Interop, our typical way of testing was to throw a bunch of junk traffic or attack traffic against the network. How is this different, that we can simulate specific issues that we might have in a real-world network?
Well, think of it this way. The smart bits and the Ixias are testing what goes across the wire. The Maxwell and now the KMAX are actually modifying the wire. So one of the things that I used to like doing for firewall testing is I'd go and create a mesh of VPNs, but at least one of the sites, I would make like the equivalent of a Hughes VSAT connection to a branch office in Beijing, literally halfway across around the world. And the only tool I could use for that would be something like the Maxwell. And so some of the articles you've read in the past on InfraWorld and so forth have had the Maxwell involved with it.
Right, right. Curtis, I'm going to ask more of course, because we're going to you. This is more the executive side. I know a lot of CTOs and CFOs who can't justify buying a piece of test gear that will degrade the network, because to them, they don't understand that. I mean, you want to make your networks faster. You want to make your networks more secure. They don't understand why you would spend a lot of money to deliberately attack or degrade the network. Has that changed in the last 5 years? I mean, are more and more high-level officers understanding of the need to be able to, on demand, simulate problems with a real-world network?
You know, I think they are. Back in the days when landlines ruled and all of your communications came from AT&T or something about that size, companies really didn't worry about it. They assumed a particular level of reliability, knowing that what they were giving up in exchange for that was money and lack of features. Well, today we have an explosion in features. The cost has come down by orders of magnitude. And what has changed is that you can't always assume that a voice or a data link is going to be rock solid. So I think that the executives do understand that there can be very valid reasons to test what would happen if the data or the voice quality was degraded in particular situations. This is especially important because the user experience has become everything. So if you've got customers that are trying to reach you via data links, via voice lines, you want to make sure that they're getting the best experience possible. And you also want to make sure that you know what's going to happen if the link quality isn't what you would hope. So do they get a bad experience? Is it a mildly reduced experience? Or does the contact go away completely? Those are critical pieces of information if you're building a modern enterprise and one in which you have to use voice and data links to reach your customers.
Yeah, and I'm really hoping that you're right there. I'm hoping that the mindset has shifted. We've got Scott Aron in the chat room, and I actually want to throw this back to you, Karl. Scott Aron, of course, loves SCADA. He loves supervisory control and data acquisition devices. And his big thing is he's been pushing for years to do this kind of testing, to say, well, what happens to your devices, which are working properly now, when the network isn't perfect, when you're getting these weird conditions? And he's saying that he always gets pushback. As you're marketing the KMAX and as you're showing demos like this, I mean, to the three of us and to most of the Twiat audience, this is an easy sell. This is absolutely a tool that you'd need. This is a tool that you would want if you're going to validate your network. How do you sell it? How do you pitch it to an executive who may or may not understand what the heck you're talking about, may have the glassy eye look when you start talking about degrading traffic so you can simulate what happens when you lose 50% of your VoIP call?
Quick detour for a second. I got a leaf blower outside my window too, which makes things worse. But I also want to say it's not just the network we're degrading. We can focus on specific things. Like we can take DNS traffic and we can tune that and say give a 100 millisecond delay behind domain name traffic. And it's surprising how much web stuff starts to collapse when you've got a long name resolution cycle. Your web servers may be as fast as lightning, but if you've got slow domain name servers, everything just gets really sluggish and the user experience is terrible. And this tool allows you to do that kind of sensitivity training. As far as marketing goes, I'm not a marketing person. I couldn't, sell, ice cubes to, whatever. However, I am an attorney, and I have been totally surprised over the years at the lack of attention manufacturers have paid to the potential liability that they might incur if their devices start to crumble under relatively foreseeable network conditions. We've had a lot of issues so far because they've been able to disclaim their liability, and the AT&T Mobility Concepcion case from the Supreme Court increased that. But eventually, makers of software are going to face the same sort of responsibility as the makers of Volkswagens, as the makers of almost any other product. And at that point, they're going to have to start paying more attention to testing for things that are reasonably foreseeable. And network conditions, outages of servers, delays, reordered packets, all those things are more than foreseeable. They're part of our daily lives. That's the lawyer's hat. That's the scare. That's the stick side. I'm not really good at the carrot side. That's more of a marketing issue. I know this box is, I consider it reasonably priced. And also, I also know that we have a patent on stateful modifications of protocols for the purpose of protocol testing. So I know that we're essentially safe from competitors such as Spire and Nixia in that regard. But I don't know how to get into people's minds and say, oh, I don't need to test my cars over rough roads. It'd be like Ford not ever testing one of their vehicles over a test track with bumps and things like that. They do that regularly. I don't know why software people don't.
Yeah, it sounds like this. We're talking about this is the new due diligence. You test your equipment for this. That's if you want to be a major manufacturer, a vendor, this is expected.
If I were an insurance company, I'd be scared.
Exactly. I want to get to Chibert on this a little bit later because I could see him frothing in the mouth in my monitor. His big thing is you can pay me now or you can pay me later. Let's talk about that in a bit. But I have to ask, because we've got people in the chat room who are interested, what's the pricing on one of these units?
Boy, I'm not really a person to give things the prices because I tend to give things away.
That's good. Okay. Hey, you heard it here. It's free.
It's not free. I'm not the person who has control of that. Let me put up a URL here you can go to for some more information. There it is, if you've got it on the screen.
There.
And
super high-tech, folks.
Yeah. Good old paper. And, yeah, that's probably the page. I do not know the pricing. I know it is not terribly, well, some people consider anything that's not free to be terribly exorbitant. But asking about pricing.
Well, tell them they get $500 off if they go here.
She's the marketing side. She's the sales side. I got that.
Can you see that? Oh, there we go.
Can you hear her? She's saying you can get $500 off by going to that.
Okay.
For a limited time only. And all the other standard disclaimers.
Okay, I'll cut away from because obviously you don't want to talk about pricing.
This again is our introductory unit.
Right.
It's the smallest of what will be a family. It's this one has only got one control interface, two other interfaces, and they're 10, 100, 1,000 interfaces. The other units that will come later on are higher capacity, possibly more interfaces, and definitely more packet per second capacity, and we'll also have some more functionality. Right. But this, again, we've got to get our feet wet with this software and weed out the bugs and problems and user interface things. We have pushed the web browser to the wall here. We are using HTML5 and WebSockets and every other thing you can think of in there. So we are pushing web browsers pretty hard, too. And the whole thing's got RESTful interfaces, so it can be controlled without any user interface. You could wire this into an offline harness. All that sort of thing.
Right.
It also supports multiple users at the same time, doing the same sort of thing. They're collaborating. It's not meant to be multiple users doing different things. So we've got a lot of stuff in there which we're testing out for a new product.
Chibert, I want to give you the last word here because we have run overtime now. Curtis has talked about executive acceptance of this kind of testing. Carl has talked about due diligence, how this has become the new normal. When you sell it, you're a little less tactful. You basically tell people you're going to pay. You can either pay now or you can pay later. What's your take on this kind of real-world testing?
It needs to happen. It really does. One of the things that we used to do, especially with all these big InfoWorld tests that I did, is we'd go and hold the vendor's feet to the fire, and if they published it in their brochures, we'd test for it. Now, the unfortunate fact of life is the customers aren't demanding this anymore. I'm not doing a lot of these big tests anymore because nobody wants to pay for them. And the reality is we're kind of like the Consumer Reports for high-end networking gear. And customers keep saying, well, that's fine. And they go and believe the salesman and they don't demand testing. So if you want products that are actually going to perform as advertised, you, the consumer, have to vote with your dollars. And I think that's my big message is it's definitely like that old Fram oil filter commercial. Pay me now or pay me later. Sure, it's a little more expensive now, but what is an outage going to cost you? You know, I'm actually doing a KMAX test with smart meters to find out if we're going to start controlling inverters on households, are we going to control them in time or are we going to be so slow that we're going to blow up a transformer? Well, we'd like to avoid that, so we're going to test for it.
Gentlemen, I want to thank you very much for being part of this panel. Folks, that's right. You've used up another hour listening to the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 out of order packets. I want to thank all my panelists, my co-hosts, and my guests, of course, for being here to make this show what it is. Carl, let's start with you. You know, every time you come on, I always remind myself we have to have you on sooner. I think it's been a year since the last time you were on. Let's not wait that long. Where can they find you? Where can they find the KMAX? What do you want to tell our audience? What do you want to leave them with?
Well, the network is far from perfect, and it's possibly getting worse now that we're getting more and more implementations. Everybody's brother thinks they can implement something. And as we get more into the phrase I hate, Internet of Things, we're going to have some really interesting emergent effects. Feedback loops are going to be formed as devices react with one another. And we're going to have interesting kind of a resonance of the Internet. It's going to cause problems and issues we cannot foresee at this time. So testing is really important.
Absolutely. Karl Auerbach of InterWorking Labs. He is the guru that Chibert and I go to whenever we need to find out what's happening in the network world. Karl, again, thank you for being on This Week in Enterprise Tech. We will have you back again. And feel free to ping us when you've got new announcements, because I know our audience loves to hear from you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. Of course, we need to thank our co-host, starting with Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, we're going to be together next week. In fact, I think we're having a dinner on Sunday. Where are we going?
Good question. Now, that's in early March. We got a little time.
Oh, no, that's right. No, I'm sorry. I'm thinking about Barcelona. Yeah, we got a month.
I would love to meet you for a meal in Barcelona, but unfortunately, I won't be there. We will, however, be in Orlando for Enterprise Connect, and I'm looking forward, still doing some research, But I can guarantee you that the meal will be epic.
Fantastic. And what can they expect to find on Information Week Radio this week?
You know, we're continuing to work towards the Information Week Elite 100 conference in early May. That happens concurrently with the first 2 days of Interop. So we've got a bunch of new radio stuff getting ready to happen. And as for me, I'm diving deeply into DevOps, Agile, and all things programming for Information Week. So getting geeky on the programming side.
Diving deeply into DevOps. Well, Chibert, I don't think your alliteration is quite as good as Curtis's, but what do you have going on that rhymes?
No rhyming, but I am working very hard on getting all the curriculum ready for a fall launch of Oceanography 418, which is going to be co-taught by four other people, and we're going to be teaching students how to build their own science instrumentation.
Wow. Okay. Well, maybe you can bring that onto a know-how. I think we would enjoy that. Gentlemen, thank you, thank you, thank you again. And thankfully, this is not a pre-recorded episode. This is an actual live episode on Fridays, and it has been an absolute pleasure to speak with you all. All right. Folks, we also want to thank you. That's right. The person who downloads us every week, the person who's watching live, the person who gets our audio version in the car so that you can listen to us on the way to work, or on our tablet so that you can watch us on your break, or maybe on your PC, your Mac, your desktop, your laptop, so you can watch us when you get home. Well, we want to make it easier for you to do that. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/twiet, and there not only will you find all of our back episodes in case you missed one, but you will find a subscription feed so you can get your format of choice into your device of choice. Also, don't forget that we do this show live most Fridays at 1:30 p.m. Pacific time. If you go to live.twit.tv, you can watch us live, see the pre-show, the post-show, and everything in between. And you can also jump into our chat room at irc.twit.tv in case you want to, well, interact with us. I've got a little screen right below my camera so that if you want to bring your discussion, your conversation into the show, again, irc.twit.tv. Don't forget that you can find me on Twitter at twitter.com/PadreSJ. It's one of the best places to suggest topics for future episodes or guests, as well as to figure out what we're going to be doing. And anytime I get particularly excited, you'll normally find posts from me, and you'll know what I've been working on. Finally, I want to thank everyone here at the studio who makes this show possible. Of course, to Lisa and Leo and Carson, my super producer, and the man who, well, I just got to say, he is a handsome man. He's a paragon of manliness.
Oh, so maybe I shouldn't show my camera then?
No, the only reason why I'm saying this is he gets really nervous anytime I start complimenting him. Mr. Cranky Hippo Brian Burnett, what do you do here, Brian?
I do a how-to show with you every Thursday. Actually, tonight we'll be doing two pre-recorded episodes. Are we going to be showing those on the live stream?
I think so. And actually, one of them involves networking, and another one involves a device that has not yet been released.
So stay tuned. Yeah. Keep watching the live stream and check that out later.
How about that? Thank you, folks, for watching another episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the Digital Jesuit, just reminding you, if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep twiet.